Praise the Lord. God wants His church to grow and sinners to come to repentance. And for this, we need to preach the gospel to them. We need to do it strategically and with a vision of growth. The Apostle Paul asked in Romans 10:14, "How then will they invoke the one in whom they have not believed? And how will they believe in the one they have not heard of? And how will they hear without someone to preach to them?" Our answer to this question is evangelism, through small groups using the strategy of Jesus. And now, simplify. This is the new step we are taking to assist all the churches. Those who still for some reason have a hard time understanding it, or they just do not know how to do it. Now it will be presented by levels. That is, there will be material for the church that is advanced. There will be also material for the church that has already launched the vision and has small groups or friendship groups in action. And finally, there will be material for those churches that wish to begin this evangelistic program. The strategy of Jesus S aims to reach all our churches, no matter what level they are at. There will be materials for everyone. In my presidential message of September 2017 Joint Bishops Meeting, I wrote about the history of the strategy of Jesus, and I said the following. In 2007, after many hours of study and dedication, the original strategy of Jesus was launched. Unfortunately, the legal problems that the church was going through caused the strategy of Jesus' work to decrease in intensity. Although some continue with the vision of church growth, in 2010, once again, the strategy of Jesus now was relaunched, but the storm that struck the church 2 years later caused the vision to stop, and the church took a different course. In 2017, the strategy of Jesus 2.0 was launched. Once again, with faith and vision, we gave ourselves to the task of working on the materials and promoting the vision with bishops and pastors. Unfortunately, in 2018, we had to take another break because of the departure of some renowned leaders among us, who, as they left our ranks, left problems that we have to attend to urgently, taking much of our time. But thank God that while we were attending to these matters, God was still saving souls. The strategy of Jesus was still alive in many churches, and the evangelistic work never stopped. And now, difficult things we have to go through look easier. God gave us victory, although we cannot let our guard down. In 2019, once again, we launched the strategy of Jesus Simplify. So after 12 years of adjustments, abandonments, and relaunches, we see how this method of church growth has prevailed despite everything that has happened. History has shown us that the Apostolic Assembly has not been able to develop a full period of the strategy of Jesus. Over the years, there have always been obstacles, and lately, the coronavirus pandemic. Over the years, we have seen how this evangelistic tool and church growth model went through the crucible of acceptance and difficulties. We have also seen, as churches that understood the vision, today experience a blessed congregation of people passionate about the salvation of the lost. On the other hand, we see churches that did not grasp the vision or simply find it difficult to understand it, do not grow, and all they're doing is maintaining rather than growing. What I have been passionate about my whole life has been and is the salvation of souls, to find ways and methods to be more effective. My doctoral thesis was on church growth. This has been a topic that has always motivated me. I like to apply and teach it, and like to advise leaders who need help growing their congregation. It is very important that you understand that there is no difference in the basic teachings or the model since its origins in 2007. The strategy of Jesus original, and now in 2020, the strategy of Jesus Simplify. The only substantial difference is in the structure and application. In other words, we're making it easier to understand and easier to practice. On the other hand, in all these years, we have talked to many pastors who do have small groups in their churches, but they do not understand all the support that small groups need to multiply and develop. That is why we have decided to make the pastors work easier to get them to develop to the entire small group program and not just part of it. From there comes the idea of the strategy of Jesus, simplify. Because it simplifies or makes easier the pastoral work. That's why we divide it into three stages or levels, basic, medium, and advanced. This was done for the purpose of each pastor in the Apostolic Assembly to identify with each of these stages or levels. And from there, he can depart to climb to master the subject completely and become an expert in the strategy of Jesus. This is the main idea, that all of us who work with small groups in our church understand that we can move forward to the point of becoming a small group church and not just a church with a small groups. That takes time, effort from the pastor and the congregation, and also a lot of work and dedication. But that's the price you have to pay if you really want to grow. My vision for the local churches is that they break the mark of 100, 250, and 500 members in their congregations, and that the Apostolic Assembly break the mark of 1,000 churches in the country. A pastor once said to me, "Aren't you afraid to give those numbers? What if it's not met? You're going to look bad." It is true. Perhaps I will be a little embarrassed, but what if we do hit those numbers? Do not be afraid to present numbers to your congregation. Do not be afraid to release the vision with numbers for the rest of 2020 and 2021. Do it in faith. Start working with small groups. Adopt the strategy of Jesus, simplify. Adapt it to your churches, and I guarantee you, you will receive results. It all starts with the first step of faith. Do not think that your church will never grow, because it is going to grow. I truly believe that. That is the will of God. To achieve this, we all have to be on the same page. Vision. We can have two or more visions, because if we do, then the plan is weakened and the path becomes confusing. That is why I asked Bishop Vice President Felipe Salazar and his team to have these evangelistic seminars, even if they are virtual, so that everyone will fortify and reaffirm their work and more souls can come at the feet of Jesus. May God bless you and keep you, and may God bless the Apostolic Assembly.
Praise the Lord, everybody. I come to you today with this lesson that I have to give credit to Brother Gabriel Pereira Las Neves, our missionary in Portugal that did the main part of this research. And I just added a few portions to the lesson. And the lesson has to do with the history of cell groups and the church in crisis. Romans 8:28 says, "We know that all things work together for good to them that love God." God has everything in control. Over the centuries, the church's cell movement has experienced successive waves, appearing and disappearing, and sometimes almost entirely. However, this fluctuation in cell groups has demonstrated a progressive trend in history, and contrary to what many might think, its greatest advances have been achieved in times of crisis. Undoubtedly, the 20th century has been the most spasmodic regarding historical records and will be remembered for its impressive series of catastrophic events such as wars, plagues, genocides, revolutions, etc., many of them having global effects. However, several scholars in the history of the church believe that in the 20th century, there was also a second Christian Reformation, a significant paradigm shift through which the church of the 21st century has become more cellular in nature than ever. Statistics confirm this point. And today, it can be said that small group ministry is the new norm in many places around the world. We believe that God has used cell groups in the church age to reach, disciple, and consolidate multitudes of believers, and continues to do so despite the adverse circumstances we are now facing. Moreover, these circumstances act as a real catalyst for cell ministry, as the study will show. In this conference of the Jesus Strategy, we will demonstrate that the cell group ministry of the church is a great driving force in the expansion of the kingdom of God, not only in so-called normal times, but also and especially in times of crises like the ones we are experiencing, which the COVID-19 pandemic is causing throughout the entire world. Before we continue, let's ask ourselves the following. Is God using the current crisis to teach us something? Could it be possible that one of God's sovereign purposes in this historical moment is to bring us back to our oldest roots, that is, to the life of the early church, as presented to us by the book of Acts of the Apostles? We believe that this is not only possible, but also very likely and even necessary. Surely there's an important lesson that God expects us to learn as a church by which it's by what is happening around us today. So let's try and dig into this and discover it. It is true that the current global crisis has no historical precedent in certain respects. Some of them related to technological advancement and globalization. For example, today we have very easy access to data and information which we didn't have before. Thanks to the internet and to television, the news is updated and communicated almost in real time. This is something very new. However, the crisis is not new. Our pioneers have already faced similar difficulties in their time, and even greater than ours in this noble task of implementing cell groups and planting churches in our cities and countries where we serve the Lord. And we must add that our Christian ancestors, mainly in the Middle East and in some regions of Europe and Africa, fought against different types of opposition that we have not seen in the West, at least not until now. We're talking about well-documented persecutions, imprisonments, tortures, martyrdoms that they had to suffer because of the gospel, in addition to wars, famines, and plagues that occurred practically in every recent century. So it will be good if in this conference we look at a little through the lens of history, how cell ministry or the church in homes managed to keep the flame of the gospel burning and sustain the advancement of the church despite the difficult circumstances surrounding each era. But before we discuss this matter, let us remember the five purposes of the cell group in the strategy of Jesus, which are worship, discipleship, ministry, companionship or fellowship, and evangelism. Can a Christian cell group in and of itself develop and sustain such purposes successfully? The answer is absolutely yes. And we can base it no less than on the book of Acts of the Apostles. However, such versatility of the cell group does not mean the small groups in the first century function independently of each other. We can easily see in the New Testament that the churches in the homes were part of a larger unit. Cell groups and the larger meetings, the celebration meetings, coexisted. Cell group believers felt part of a mother church in that city. This shows that the church's cell ministry has been and continues to be very effective in the mission of taking the gospel to a greater number of people than those who were able to be reached through a central place of worship, thus providing more believers with the opportunity to develop a meaningful Christian lifestyle, much more like the biblical pattern. We're referring to the universal priesthood model of believers, the ministry of the saints, if you please, which is the Lord's plan for each member of his church to develop a contributing ministry to the building of this church of Jesus Christ. Missionary Gabriel Pereira Das Neves says, "We categorically say that cell groups continue to be very successful in the mission of expanding the kingdom, because in addition to the history we will consider briefly, we have our own experience. For example, let me tell you what is happening right now with our mission in Portugal. Before the pandemic began in March, our cells in the Lisbon region were a few dozen people. Our church is a new missionary work. But since the stay at home was decreed in our country and mobility was greatly reduced, we have been reaching hundreds of people, not a dozen people, hundreds of people every week. How? Through virtual meetings. Now, we, instead of lamenting that we cannot have in-person cell group meetings, we thank the Lord for this virtual resource, because it is by this means that we have managed in just a few weeks to connect with people from 10 or more countries on 4 continents. The Lord has surprised us totally. In short, the current pandemic crisis has really helped us, has driven us, leading us to having to adapt to the new normal, as it is now called. We give glory to God because Romans 8:28 does not fail. God is on his throne. Zoom, Messenger, Facebook Live, and YouTube has expanded our reach at Merced New Life. We're reaching the families of our new converts that have been confined since our meetings are being live streamed into their homes. A Zoom friendship group prayer meeting reached a lady in Palmdale, California, not long ago, who in a prayer meeting via Zoom received the Holy Ghost, then received Bible studies, and 3 months later came to Merced to be baptized in the wonderful name of Jesus Christ. Our live stream is reaching some of my family in Mexico, as well as some of our friendship group leaders' families, who have said they are ready to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. It's almost an occurrence or a weekly occurrence that somebody comes by, drops off an offering, and it says, "We are watching, we are in your meetings, we're in your celebration services. As soon as this lifts, this is our church." And when I ask them who they are, sometimes it says, "We really don't want you to give us credit by name for this offering." God is just doing something powerfully during these days. I can tell you that in just one transmission, we had over 1,500 hits. God is doing the work today, and to God be the glory. Let me take some time right now and go through history and give you some supporting facts of why we feel that God has allowed this today, this pandemic crisis, to bring us back to the roots, to our roots in the book of Acts. So let me talk about cell groups and crisis in history. The first person that I want to talk about is Pedro Obando. In early 1180 in Lyon, France, this preacher of the gospel, considered to be the first Protestant leader, was excommunicated by the Catholic Church and expelled from his city. Then Valdo's followers decided to exit with him, leaving everything behind. This is how the Waldensian evangelical movement had its beginning, primarily moving from house to house. The Catholic Inquisition failed to weaken it, failed to destroy it. On the contrary, the Waldensians developed a system through which they entered a city and met secretly in small groups, where believers ministered one unto another. There they ate and prayed together and partook of the Lord's Supper. In this simple way, the Waldenses extended their cell ministry throughout Europe. By the end of the 12th century, a third of all European Christianity, yes, you heard that right, a third of all European Christianity are believed to have attended some secret network meeting of Waldensian cell groups. Let me talk to you a little bit about John Wycliffe. In the 14th century, this English teacher and theologian founded the movement called the Lollards, which were considered to be the worst heretics in England. They really weren't an organized structure movement, but rather people who gathered secretly in small groups in homes because of fear of the queen. They gathered to study and to memorize long passages of the Bible. At that time, it was very expensive and very dangerous to own a Bible or even a book written about the Bible. Therefore, many Lollards decided to possess the Bible in the only way they could, by memorizing it during their long meetings, which often lasted all night. It was common for a Lollard young man to recite by heart the entire book of Luke or the book of Job. Lollard small groups tended to be homogeneous. That means that they were all men's group, all ladies group, and groups of marriages. John Hus, in the 15th century, a Bohemian born Christian, commonly accepted as the second reformer, pushed for changes that would later become known as the Czech Reformation. As a young man, he was martyred for his faith in the Word of God and his preaching. But his house-to-house movement continued to advance through several European countries, subsequently giving rise to the modern missionary movement. The secret gathering in the homes allowed Hus's followers to survive even the fierce persecution that took place against them and other Christian groups in the 17th century. The Puritans, an English movement that believed that churches had become corrupted and that they had to separate themselves from them. The Puritan separation was a gradual process lasting a whole century. The separatist Puritans began forming small groups throughout England under the direction of a minister. These groups met secretly in members' homes. As early as the 17th century, while being persecuted by the British crown, mainly North America, it says, received the benefit as they immigrated to the United States and the rest of North America. God definitely used the Puritan cell group movement to arouse a zeal for holiness and a practice of biblical Christian lifestyle in several countries on both sides of the Atlantic. In the 18th century, John Wesley, the father of the Methodist Church, established what were called societies. John Wesley, the founder in the movement that began in England, encouraged different kinds of small groups to develop so that both leaders and members of the societies could receive support and be challenged in their faith. It's interesting to note that Wesley and his followers ministered during the smallpox epidemic in Europe. It was in the 18th centuries that a vaccine was developed, it says, to combat smallpox. Yet the church did not go back, but it advanced and moved forward during this epidemic. John Wesley's groups, many places called classes and bands, met regularly, and the idea was to be accountable to each other about how each person was living in the Christian life, growing in relationship with one another, as we say it in our small group meetings. So people had to be very open and willing to be changed by that small group experience. The societies Wesley founded became the dominant form of the independent Methodist movement that continues to this day. Statistics show that the Methodist Church grew rapidly and consistently, recording 1,400,000 members by 1851. That, my friend, that, my brother, is growth. In the 20th century, it became less common for classes to meet in this way. But recently, many Methodists have been trying to reclaim this form of ministry. The supportive small group has been found to be one of the most powerful ways for people to feel that they belong and to learn and grow. A little closer to home, the Apostolic Church says we have William Seymour. As early as the 20th century, the book History of Modern Pentecostalism on page 3 records that William Seymour could not find a place to hold his meetings. So with the congregation recently established, he moved to Edward Lee's house, where a small group prayed for a spiritual awakening. When the number of congregants grew, Richard and Ruth Asbury opened their home on Bonnie Bray Street to the congregation. The ensuing revival and all that accompanied is now history, which we are greatly a part of. The small group movement in America has gone through many crisis moments, such as World War I and the Great Depression. Michael C. Mack, in his article, The Pioneers of the Small Group Movement, writes, according to Frank Lincoln Fowler III, the first use of the term small group movement goes back to the 1920s and the 1930s, when Calvary Episcopal Church in New York City utilized several principles central to the eventual spread of the small group movement in the church. Lyman Coleman, one of the great promoters of small groups in the late 20th century, says, in the early days, the small group movement was primarily an underground movement. That's kind of odd for him to say that. But what was he saying? Was that the established church didn't want anything to do with it. Some of you that are hearing me right now know what I'm talking about. This seems to have been the general feeling in the American church. But thank God the Apostolic Assembly has since rediscovered the biblical method of evangelism and discipleship before the COVID-19 pandemic hit. Very little is said of the Pentecostal revival of the 20th century beyond the borders of the United States. But reality is that it took place almost simultaneously in countries as distant as Australia, Korea, India, Wales, Brazil, and several other countries. Facts of this can be found today in several well-documented Christian books. Books written by men like Joel Comiskey and others that you can find on the internet. The revivals of the 20th century, as well as others from previous centuries, all show a common factor. This common factor was prayer in the homes. Prayer in the homes. Or I can say home ministry. The revival among the Moravians in the 18th century began with only two prayer groups of 12 people each, who carried out the commitment to an uninterrupted prayer chain that lasted for many years. The Welsh revival in the 18th century began with only two elderly sisters who opened a prayer group in their home, as it was no longer easy for them to attend worship in a temple because of their advanced stage or their advanced age. What am I saying today? That all it takes is for two people to commit to having revival, and it can begin in your home. And we could cite many more examples, even in countries as far away as Iran, India, China, or Russia, where large underground cell movements, which met secretly because of government bans, continue to grow. I'm talking about exponentially and to forward and advance, says the cell group movement. So even in the most difficult times in history, such as World War I and the Spanish flu pandemic of 1918, which killed millions of people on five continents, or the Great Depression of 1929 that caused hunger, misery, death around the world, the cell movement of the church has always found its opportunity to grow and multiply, reaching millions of people in different places and times. We previously raised the question about what God could possibly want to teach us through the current COVID-19 pandemic. One of Jesus' parables could help us with and give us an answer. When the prodigal son returned home, he had to acknowledge that he had squandered his father's inheritance to him. And while in dire misery, the young man reflected on his situation, decided to return home, and even rehearsed the words he would say to his fathers once he would arrive. We're not going to question the sincerity of his repentance here, but it's very clear that while the prodigal was spending money on his friends, while he had it good financially, while everything seemed to be going just great, he didn't have any thought of going back home. It was hunger. It was a crisis that made him reflect upon how good he had it at home and gave him the desire and the will to return home. Pastors and leaders, could the current crisis be our Father's call to return home? Is God challenging us through this situation to change certain paradigms or methods of church work or the establishing of priorities in the service we render to Him? We think so. In recent years, as an organization, we have allocated many resources to buildings and to different kinds of activities. This actually is a good thing. Thank God that we've been able to do this. But there's one question that we should ask ourselves. How productive were these endeavors to the expansion of God's kingdom? We should acknowledge that they have not always been as productive as we wish they would have been, at least not directly. The truth is that in light of the present challenges that we face today, it says, as we study the stories of countless men and women of God and considering the word of the Lord, today we can affirm that we are facing an awesome and unique opportunity to accept the challenge issued by God to change, to reinvent ourselves, to forsake certain traditional old wineskin models and embrace new methods of evangelism, which are better suited to these times, to the new normal that has come upon us. We are convinced that the strategy of Jesus in the local church, particularly and especially the small groups, with its well-placed focus on the five purposes we have already mentioned, is the answer to the challenge we are facing. Apostolic Assembly, this crisis is not going to stop this ministry. It's going to make it stronger. The key is knowing how to adapt and take full advantage of the opportunity we have been afforded. We must break some promises that we have made it to ourselves that we will never have small groups in our church. And we must say, God, forgive us for being a little narrow-minded, because you were trying to prepare us a long time ago. But give us the grace to do so today. Brothers and sisters in the Lord, in this special moment of history, we invite you to be like the palm tree, one of the most storm-resistant trees. It is rare for a palm tree to break or fall. The secret is its flexible trunk. The palm tree bends to the effect of strong tropical winds, sometimes making it touch the ground with its crown, but straightens back up. It doesn't break. It bends with the adverse conditions. Apostolic Assembly, let's be like the palm tree. The Lord does not want to break us. He just wants to bend us a little. In this crisis, we have the flexibility to make the changes we must make, overcoming any doubts or unfounded fears. We have seen that discipleship and training has been possible in our Asian countries, where God has allowed us to go in and pioneer new churches. Let us now, more than ever, promote small groups in our churches, motivating and empowering our members to establish cell groups in their homes. Let us make each home an altar for the Lord. Church, this is our time. In conclusion, this is an invitation to be part of the wonderful history of the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ, to be the champions of these special times with so many challenges and opportunity. In this last hour of his church, Jesus extends this invitation to all of us. Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Preach it in person when you can. Preach it in small groups, via Zoom or any other virtual means. Preach it through YouTube channel. Preach it through Facebook Live. Just preach the gospel. Disciple people in their homes. Let's get into people's homes as the first century church did. If we're not allowed to do it inside the home, let's find backyards that are big where we can keep social distancing. Let's find shade trees. Let's find Zoom methods. Let's use Messenger. Let's use every way possible to preach the gospel to every creature. Because he who believes and is baptized will be saved. But he who does not believe will be condemned. And how are they going to believe in someone they have never heard preached? And how are they going to preach if they're not sent? God is sending his church into this last day harvest. Oh, let's be encouraged, church. Let's be encouraged. God is with us. We know that all things work together for good to them that love God and to those who are called according to his purpose. This is our purpose, church. Preach, teach, make disciples of all nations. In the name of Jesus Christ, I challenge you today. May God bless you. Amen.
Praise the Lord. I'm Pastor Jim Morales here at Faith Tabernacle in San Diego, California. I am so excited about the opportunity to come to you and speak about small groups. I want to acknowledge and appreciate our Bishop President, Dr. John Fortino, and our Vice President, Bishop Philip Salazar, the General Board, and the Committee of the Strategy of Jesus Simplified, for giving me this opportunity to partake in the teaching, in all of the resources that through our Apostolic Assembly, they are giving to us, the pastors, ministers, deacons, and leaders, in order for us to move the church forward. You see, it is in God's divine purpose and plan for the church to move forward even in the face of opposition. As we are going through this pandemic, I believe that God is giving us the greatest opportunity to rethink, to restructure, and perhaps even re-strategize, to renew and restart what God has always wanted the church to do, and that is to go and to make disciples. As it is said in the book of Acts chapter 2, verse 42 through 47, I want to take this portion of scripture as our scripture base, as we are going to be speaking about the strategy of Jesus with the focus on small groups. You may know them as life groups in your church, perhaps impact groups as we call them here in our church, friendship groups, or any support group that studies the Word of God. The Bible says that they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold their property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day, they continued to meet together. Where? In the temple courts. And they broke bread. Where? In their homes. Notice that it was from the temple and to the homes. As many of us in our churches are having to now celebrate our worship service, no longer within the four walls of our church buildings, but now we are in the outer courts. We are in the patio, or perhaps our church parking lot, as we did this past Sunday. And the early church did that in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts. And verse 47 says, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. You see, this is a new season that perhaps we never had encountered before in our ministry. As I speak to pastors, ministers, deacons, bishops, elders, laymen, and women, this is a challenging season. These are times that we never had encountered before in our lifetime. I never thought, I never imagined that I would have to pastor our church, our congregation, through a pandemic. Now, I must be sincere and transparent that when all of this started, perhaps we thought that we would have to go through this for a month, 2 months, 3 months. But now we are in this for 6 months. And it looks like this is going to continue further. The Bible speaks of the sons of Issachar, that they were men that knew the times in which they were living in. I believe that we also are like the sons of Issachar. And as we seek God out in prayer and in fasting, God is giving us the wisdom, the courage, and the valor that we need to stand up firm in our faith. God has called us to lead the church. And as we lead by example, in this time of trial and of testing, God is allowing us to restart. Amen. God is allowing us to prepare ourselves for what lies ahead. So the question is asked, how do we continue to move forward in this pandemic? How do we continue to establish the principles that God has given the church? As we look to God in prayer and as we study the scriptures, God takes us to that early church. The Bible says in Acts chapter 5, verse 42, that day after day in the temple courts and from house to house, they never stopped teaching and proclaiming the good news that Jesus is the Messiah. The church of the book of Acts, we know it is a proven fact that it was a cellular church. It was a church that was being established in the homes. It started with 120. They were together in one mind and in one accord. The Spirit of God fell upon them, and they were empowered to go and to make disciples, as it had been given the commandment by Christ Himself to go and to make disciples. It is called the Great Commission. We are to win the lost. We are to equip them, build them up, and then send them out. That was the character and model of Jesus Christ. And the Bible says in Acts chapter 2, verse 47, that the Lord was adding daily to the church. Why? Because in every house where the Word of God was being proclaimed, where the Word of God was being taught, many were coming to know Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. As we go back to that early church, we can understand and we can see that they had two types of meetings. Now remember, I'm speaking specifically about the strategy of Jesus with the focus on small groups. We see that early church establishing the church in the homes. Small in the houses and big in the outer courts in the temple. Big in their celebration and small in their teaching in the homes. You see, the focus has always been and should be, and more than ever before, I believe that God is allowing us to see this more clearly. He is breaking down our traditions, our traditional mindset. In other words, that old wineskin will not be able to receive and to have the new wine unless we have a new wineskin. That is why we must rethink how we are doing church and refocus on how we continue to do church from here onward. The focus must be small groups. The focus must be the strategy of Jesus. It has been established. It has been a vision that has been evolving. I have been a part of the strategy committee for many years now. I can recall that in 2008, if I'm not mistaken, in the city of Dallas, Texas, in one of our conventions. This vision had been unfolded. I didn't understand too much of what that meant at that time, but by trial and error, as we began to pursue God and this vision that God had given to us by our leaders, that is found in the Word of God. It is not a vision that is man-made, but it is a vision that comes from God and is given to the church as we see it here in the book of Acts. We know it as the strategy of Jesus, and now we have added the word simplified. Something that is simple, and we are all able to understand and apply to our church vision and ministry. What are cell groups? What is a small group? It is a meeting in our homes where we meet with our family, friends, brethren from the church, perhaps our neighbors, and even our co-workers. People that we are inviting to come and to receive the word of the Lord. Now, in this season, we have had to restructure and adapt and adjust to how we do our meeting. I believe that in this season, God is allowing us to go back to our roots, to our origin, to being that church of the book of Acts, where we are now concentrated in our homes because of this pandemic. God is allowing us to go back to the homes. It is the place where we have to establish the small group. We are no longer able to come to our sanctuaries. And we know that God is not limited to four walls. We've known that all of our lives. But perhaps we had fallen into that trap of just having church in our building. But today, this challenge of this pandemic of COVID-19 has allowed us to open up our understanding and to go to God in prayer. And He has given us insight, revelation through His Word, and to focus on our family, to put the focus on every member in our church. Every member is a leader. Every member can give a Bible study. Every member can do the work that God has called us all to do. This pandemic has moved us to retake the strategy of Jesus. Now, just as a summary, in phase one, we have three elements that we see unfold. The first is the evangelistic cycle. Some of us are very familiar with this, while others, this is new for you. For churches that are being planted, for new works, small churches, it don't matter the size. Perhaps you might be new to the cellular model or the strategy of Jesus simplified. But know that there are three elements. The second is cell groups, small groups. And the third is the school of discipleship. Now, the school of discipleship has four levels. Number one, it is the new birth. Number two, to grow in your faith. Number three, to mature. And number four, to multiply. Now, I'm not going to go in depth in those areas. That is for another time. My focus is on the strategy of Jesus simplified with the small groups. The strategy of Jesus is not about maintaining the church, but it is more so about growing the church. You see, that is the purpose of God. It has always been the desire of God to see many souls come to the knowledge of the truth, to repent of their sins, and to be all that they can be and live the abundant life. It is about doing the will of God. It is about the Great Commission and being about our Father's business, which is loving God and loving people as it is found in Mark chapter 12, verse 30 and verse 31. Love the Lord with all of your heart, with all of your mind, with all of your soul, with all of your strength. And we know that that is the first commandment, and the second is as important as the first. And that is to love our neighbor as we love ourselves. And that universal scripture that says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. The Bible says that he came to seek and to save that which was lost. That was his objective. That was his purpose. That no man would perish, but that every man would come to repentance and have everlasting life. The Bible says in Mark 16:16, he that believes and is baptized shall be saved, and he that believeth not shall be condemned. What a great opportunity we have today to do the will of God, to establish the kingdom of God through the strategy of Jesus and through cell groups, small groups in our very own homes. Now, what are the objectives of the cell groups? Number one, we know it is to grow in relationship with God. That is the first objective, that all of us, our members, visitors, and people that are coming from our community would connect to God, that they would have a relationship with God. We are not talking about religion. We are talking about having a relationship with God. And in this season and in this time, how many people are asking the question, where is God? How can I know about Jesus Christ? So many people that are in need today and that are looking for answers. Well, we have the answer, and the answer is found in Jesus Christ. It is to grow in relationship with others, to have communion with God, and to have communion with the body of Christ, the body of believers. It is to get to know one another, even as we are practicing social distancing, yes, even through our Zoom meetings, how pleasant it is for the brethren to dwell together in unity, as it is said in Psalms 133. Even though we are separate, we are still uniting together as one, as we are growing in relationship with others. How? Through our small groups. And also, we are growing in number and we are multiplying. The early church was passionate about the mission of Jesus Christ. They had a strong and firm faith in God, and they were about the Father's business. They were establishing the church where? In the cell group, in their homes. Now, there are fivefold activities in a small group. Now, we see these activities not only in the big celebration, which is our worship service. In our worship service, we have, of course, worship, which is to draw close to God. We have that also in our small group. We have discipleship, maturing in our faith as we study the Word of God. That is our primary focus, to study the Word of God. It is not a social gathering or a club. It is a place where we study the Word of God, where we grow and develop in our faith. It is a place where every member can become a minister. That is a slogan that we have adopted here in our church locally, where every member is a minister, where you are not living the abundant life until you are serving in the body of Christ. We all have something to do as we evangelize the world. But also we fellowship. It is a place where we come together. We share our needs. We help each other out as the early church did. You see, in these times in which we're living in, we have had families in our very own church that have had to endure the hardship of losing a loved one. Perhaps in your church, we have heard of many pastors that have gone on to be with the Lord. Members in our congregations from near and far. And me personally, just this past week, had 3 funerals. And another one of our members last week passed on to be with the Lord. These are things that are happening, that are unfolding before our very own eyes. But it is the church, and it is through the small group that we share in each other's hardship. There is a time to laugh together, but there is also a time to cry together, because we are part of the body of Christ. There is that slogan that we see in our culture and in our world today that says, we are in this together. Well, let me tell you that as we are going through this pandemic, it is something that we are saying here in the local church, that we are in this together. And in the small group, we get to know one another as we share in our testimonies, in our petitions. We begin to hear and to see the need in our families, and we begin to do the will of God as we serve one another. That is evangelism, fulfilling our mission and connecting our family and friends to Christ and to the body of believers. Pastors, ministers, leaders and laymen and women, what will it take? Simply put, we must have passion for God and passion to do the will of God. It is no longer enough to just believe, but we have to belong. We have to take the steps of action. We can no longer lay dormant. We cannot cross our arms and just see what is happening around the world and not do anything. We must be persistent and have an apostolic strategy. We must be willing to follow the strategy of Jesus. It is the ministry of Jesus Christ that was characterized by his passion, by his action, by his persistence, and the strategy in the homes. It is that strategy that we are talking about that is a passion for God, for souls, and to be committed to what God has called us to do, which is the mission of the church. It is to be persistent, consistent, and to have a vision, a clear vision and understanding of what that strategy is in your life as a pastor, as a minister, as a leader. Where does it all begin? Where do I start? Let us personalize it. It starts with me. It starts with you as a pastor. There where God has planted you, it is the place where God has placed you to do what God has called you to do, and that is to lead. You see, you are the man of God. You are that person that God has called to lead your church in the middle of this pandemic. In this time, in this hour, God is raising up a generation of Joshuas and of Calebs, of people of God that are willing to pay the price in order to move the church forward and onward for the glory of God. I believe that God has equipped us. God has empowered us through his Spirit and by his word, and has given us power and authority to go and to make disciples. What must we do? We must be willing to make the necessary changes. Now, I know that change is difficult, but everything is changing around us. Everything is evolving. We can no longer sit still and lay back and not make the changes that we must make in order to move forward. Early on, as the pandemic was starting, there were changes that we had to make on a dime. It was changes that we had to make every day. But they're necessary changes in order for us to adjust, adapt, and to move the church forward. What must we do? Make the changes. Be open. Be flexible. And there's a saying that goes, "Blessed are the flexible, for they shall not be broken." You need to start where you are. Now is the time. And I tell the church here all the time, just do it. I've adopted the slogan of Nike, just do it. You may not understand it. You may not have all of the resources and the tools, but as you begin to do your part, God will begin to do the rest. You do the possible, and God will do the impossible. Now, you might be saying, "Pastor, well, I know these things. You know, you're a large church, you're an established church, perhaps you're a medium-sized church. Perhaps you've already heard of the strategy of Jesus for many years, but perhaps you haven't believed in it. Perhaps you have not established a small group in your very own home." I want to speak to you, Pastor. Those that are that have small churches and those that were just planning their church or started a new work, you are our target. Because the reality is that the average church in the Apostolic Assembly, it's not 200 or 300 or 400 or 500 members. The average church in the Apostolic Assembly, I must tell you this, and it is the facts, and the numbers do not lie. The average church is from 70 to 80 members. That is our reality. It is our responsibility to evaluate our systems. Start where you are. Look at your structure, your systems. Evaluate your leadership, your team, etc., etc. But do this. Be diligent in equipping and empowering your leaders for the work of the ministry. You don't have to do it all by yourself. Start with the team that you have. Just like that early church, the Bible says in chapter 6 of the book of Acts that the tables were being unattended, that the widows were not being attended, and there was murmuring and criticism, and there was, you know, people that were not being attended because they weren't establishing the leadership. They didn't have the structure. But they began to delegate. The Bible says that they chose Stephen and they chose the other seven men and they began to equip them. They were faithful men, filled with the Holy Ghost, with a good testimony. Those are the qualities that we must look for in the men and women in our churches to delegate the responsibility. We can look at the Jethro model. I don't have enough time to talk about that. But you can go to the book of Exodus chapter 18. And you'll find out that Moses, just like many of us, was falling at the seams because he just didn't have enough strength to do what God had called him to do. And Jethro, his father-in-law, told him, "You're going to die. You're going to get sick. You're going to die because you're not able to cover all of those areas. You're going to wear yourself thin." And so what must we do? We must choose men and women in our church that are able to take the responsibility and help us to grow and to develop others and begin to do the Great Commission. Let's release them. Let's believe in them. Let's equip them and empower them to do the work of the ministry. How do you move forward? How do I move forward? Model it. Be the example. It starts with you, Pastor. It starts with us in the leadership. Because leadership, we know, is influence. The churches that are thriving, churches that are flourishing, even in spite of this pandemic, churches that are moving forward and that are even growing in the middle of a pandemic, it is amazing that even their finances are stable and even in some cases, even better than before COVID-19. Yes, we are seeing miracles, signs, and wonders. We are experiencing baptisms every month in the church. In our campus, in our mission, in the church that we planted, we are seeing baptisms. We are giving food to the community every week. We are establishing new small groups. Why? Because we are believing that this is the greatest time and an opportunity, even in spite of the challenges that the church has. We have not surrendered. We are not going back. We are not throwing in the towel, but we are moving forward, establishing Zoom Bible studies in the homes, family Bible studies in the homes, support group Bible studies in the homes and even in the workplace. We are connecting our members to the vision of the strategy of Jesus. We are establishing the strategy of Jesus in our church. Establish the strategy of Jesus with your leaders. Get their assistance, a Timothy, somebody that is going to help them do the strategy of Jesus. Connect every family. I'm giving you recommendations. Connect your families in the local church to a small group. Establish a structure. But not only that, supervise your leaders. Have a weekly meeting. And I know that this might sound like a lot of work, but as you begin to establish the structure, and we have all of the material, you're all able to download it from the Apostolic Assembly website under the strategy of Jesus Simplified. Have your weekly meeting, because responsibility without accountability is a liability. It is so important that as we empower our leaders, that we hold our leadership accountable. Here in the local church, we have our small group leaders, we have our sector supervisors, and we have our district coordinators. Now, we've been at this for quite some time, so this is nothing new to us, but we've had to adjust and adapt, and we don't have it all together. It's still a work in progress. We're always going to continue to learn, to adjust and adapt as we move forward. The church in the homes through the cell group has benefits, and I need to mention this, because even though it's hard work, it's good work. Amen. Because through small groups, through the strategy of Jesus Simplified, God gives you a clear vision for your church. People want to know that their pastor has a clear vision and an understanding of where God is wanting to take them. And you and I, pastor, have a responsibility given by God. And the Bible says that where there is no vision, the people perish. In this time, in this season, we need to go to God in prayer, in fasting. Do whatever it takes, but have a clear vision of what God is wanting you to do for the glory of God, and so that your people can embrace and make that vision, your vision, the vision that God has given to you, their vision. It is a benefit because it is a net that will help you fulfill God's divine purpose and plan for your ministry, for your life, and for your church. It is through the small groups that we're able to attend to the needs of the people. With so many things that are going on and so many new tasks that we've had to take on. And I know that we're busier than ever before. I'm doing things that I never thought I would do in the church. but it's what we have to do in order to move forward, because growth is not by accident. Growth is intentional. It is labor. It is hard work, but it is a great reward when you begin to see others supplying the needs of their brothers in Christ. Continue to grow the church, even in the midst of difficult times. Share the workload. Give responsibility to those. You'd be surprised of how many in your church are eager and are willing to learn. But we must believe in them. Take the time to equip them for the work of the ministry. You see, the strategy of Jesus provides the structure and the method whereby we can have success. Yes, have success, have growth. See the fruits of the Spirit in the lives of your members. Have baptisms, new births, new people coming to know God like never before through our online worship, through our small groups. We are having people that are not even in our city, outside of our city, in different states, and even in different countries. We've had people connect to our small group from Spain, from Mexico, from New York. We have families that are connecting every week to our small groups. I'm seeing the reports that are coming in from new families that are wanting to receive the Word of God and are giving their life over to Christ in the cell group, in the small group. And I give testimony of this. Just this week, one of our very own neighbors decided to give his life to Jesus Christ. A friend of ours, his son with my son, played baseball together, Little League. And now Joaquin Sanchez has decided to give his life over to the Lord. In another cell group, Esteban and his friend Martin and Maricela have decided to give their life over to Jesus. Just last week, we had baptisms in Mission Bay here close by of families that are attending our small group. She is a sister to one of our ministers, all the way from Texas, flew here and was baptized in Jesus' name just last week. This is happening in our cell groups. Why? Because the Word of God has power to transform the lives of men and of women. As I come to a close, there is no better time than the present. Now is the time for the apostolic assembly to shine with the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is our time to restore our calling in Christ and our apostolic identity as that of the church of the book of Acts. This is our time to act in faith. It is our time to believe that God has called us for such a time as this. We are the church of the book of Acts. And there is a chapter 29. And that chapter we are writing right now, in this present moment, before the coming of the Lord. I believe that God is giving us the opportunity of a lifetime for us to go back to our origin, to our roots. Let us return and let us be the church of the book of Acts that God established and called us to be all that we can be for the glory of God. A church that lives the strategy of Jesus, not a church that just has a model, not a church that just has a plan, but a church that is living out the strategy of Jesus in our homes, through cell groups, through small groups, preaching, teaching the Word of God, and winning the lost for the glory of God. Thank you for taking the time, for being present, and for being active in the work of the Lord. I pray that this can help you, so that you can continue together building the kingdom of God and winning people for the glory of Jesus Christ. God bless you. It has been my pleasure to serve you today. God bless.
Praise the Lord. I want to thank you for joining us on this occasion for the Strategy of Jesus seminar. I pray that it was a blessing to your life. You might be asking yourself, why is the National Committee of the Strategy of Jesus offering these seminars in our local churches? First, we want everyone in the Apostolic Assembly to catch the vision of the Strategy of Jesus. We believe in the strategy. We believe that people in the local churches catch the vision for the Strategy of Jesus, then we're going to be able to advance the mission of the church, which is to evangelize the world and to make disciples of all people. Secondly, with all of the restrictions that the government has been placing on the local churches, many churches have been struggling to try to figure out how to execute the Strategy of Jesus given all the restrictions that have been taking place. We want to be a help to the local churches. That's why, until the end of this year, we're going to be offering these conferences every other month to the English community, or in English for our local churches. The next seminar is going to be September 21st. I hope that you'll be able to join us. Our vision is that we're going to be able to train the local leaders in the local churches. And I want to thank our president, President John Fortino, for his vision and for his insistence that we communicate clearly the vision to the local churches. And I also want to thank the committee of the Strategy of Jesus for all of the work that they put in to these seminars and to the seminars that will be given here in the future. Again, I pray that this time was a blessing to you, and I hope to see you next time. God bless you. Have a great night.